Welcome to the class, folks. My name is Dennis McArthur, and today we're going to have a two-part class about a couple plants that go well together, duckweed and azolla. And duckweed and azolla are both very tiny floating pond plants. So they're almost indistinguishable to the trained eye, untrained eye. But I'm going to teach you a little bit about them and what makes them so unique and so special for our system. So the first plant that we're going to talk about is duckweed. And a lot of folks might know, but we've been growing it for a very long time here. And it's the one plant that we do grow commercially. We ship duckweed all year round, all across the United States. We started with a small scoop, a third the size that we ship, about 2 tablespoons. And now we have so much, it's spread everywhere. Duckweed reproduces asexually. It kind of just splits and splits. The duckweed that we have today for our class was grown at the Gersten Garden Pool. And she gave us about 8 cups of duckweed for the class, which is wonderful. And that was, about 4 days ago? And it's already been replaced. So, sounds like a lot, but she's growing a ton of it there. So, and she grows it a little bit everywhere. You can see, obviously, that IBC, which is one of these. The square things. She grows quite a bit of it there. And then she'll also grow underneath some of her veggies and then here and there and everywhere. And we took it a couple days ago and it's already been replaced. It will basically double in size, double in volume, in ideal conditions in up to 16 hours. 4 days, I usually tell people. It grows really fast. But there are some tricks to it. And we've been growing it long enough that we've kind of figured it out ourselves through trial and error. Now, when we first started, I was out there Googling, looking everywhere for advice on how to grow duckweed. And almost all of it was how to kill duckweed. Some people didn't like it. It was considered a noxious weed to people. But a weed is a plant with no value, and to me, it's a valuable plant. So it's certainly not a weed. So we grow it a lot. And I'll show you some pictures of different grow areas we have. This is before our fish got big. When we first started the garden pool a long time ago, it looked like a putting green. You could just walk out there, but that's all duckweed. But once our fish got big, that wasn't happening. You can see some grown on shelf ponics, bookshelves we use. I tell folks to grow duckweed in many different places. Kiddie pools. This is just the side, it's like a 2x10 area that we grow. Here's a close up of that area. This used to be our most productive area before we started growing sweet potatoes there. You can see how thick it gets.
Wow.
Some really thick stuff with a lot of duckweed. These are the raised beds that we use to feed our chickens. Throw some duckweed in there so they have access to it. And this is our next plant. This almost looks like duckweed, right? But I have this picture here that we took because you can see the 2 shades of azolla. Azolla can be a little red or a little green like duckweed, and it's the same size. I mean, I have a tray of azolla right here, and duckweed right here, and unless I told you that and you're real familiar with it, you probably think it's the same stuff. It's very similar in many different ways, but I think they're really complementary to what we're doing here at the garden pool, because one grows better at certain times and places than the other one. So, the main difference between the plants is they're entirely different plants, different families. One's a fern, the azolla is a fern, and it reproduces both sexually, like normal plants, normal ferns with spores, and also asexually, like the duckweed, so it just splits apart and grows real fast. So, the azolla grown for today's class was grown at the Fantasy Farm. And for those folks who aren't familiar with the Fantasy Farm, it's just right south of McCampville Park, down by the fairgrounds. It's a big property built in the late 20s, where we have some amazing garden pool stuff going on there. If you ever want to get your hands on and volunteer, we facilitate volunteerism, tours, that kind of stuff. And they grow a ton of azolla. Now, we couldn't get duckweed growing there kind of on a regular thing, so we switched to azolla, which is why one of the reasons why we got introduced to azolla. So I'll show you some pictures of the fantasy farm of azolla growing, and you can see how it's red and green. Some different pictures. This one looks more red. And really, it just happens to be with the amount of nutrients in there. There's no difference in the two, red or green. Sometimes it's red, sometimes it's green. Here's a close-up picture. If you look close, you can see it looks more like a fern. It has fronds. And it varies a lot in color. You can see it's bright green. You can see it's kind of a dullish green there. That's really it for the differences between the two. They're so close in nutritional level that I'm not even going to get into the differences of nutrition. They both have a lot of protein. They both have like iron, phosphorus, manganese, zinc, copper, you know, really good stuff. And a lot of protein. Both of them have like 30 to 40% protein. That's crazy. So, places, organizations, NGOs like us, nonprofits, governments have been trying to get people in developing countries to grow this stuff. And don't get me wrong, it's been used to in agriculture purposes for at least, you know, 1,000 years or more. The Chinese grow azolla when they grow rice, and they've been doing that for over 1,000 years. So when the rice comes up, this azolla that floats on top blocks the light, creating algae which can suffocate the rice. But azolla's, the best thing about azolla in comparison to duckweed is the fact that azolla pulls nitrogen from the air. How many plants do that? It pulls nitrogen from the air. So for those who aren't familiar with nitrogen, it's one of the most important nutrients that plants need, right? Nitrogen. So in aquaponics, we get it from the fish waste. That's where we get the nitrogen. So when I'm rocking small aquaponic ponds or setups, I'll use azolla instead of duckweed because it doesn't pull the nitrogen out, which a small setup might not have. So it pulls nitrogen from the air, and then the fish can eat that, and the plants, you know, can have that in their system, and it adds to our ecosystem. So out in the front yard, a small pond has azolla. So that's pretty amazing stuff. You can even use it as a fertilizer. Say you're growing as much as you are at the fantasy farm. You can let that stuff just add it to your plants, add it to your compost, and you're adding your nitrogen fixing your soil. So basically we're talking about a food source for people. Duckweed, there's a lot of research on the nutritional benefits of eating duckweed because it's a nutritious plant, grows real fast. Azolla hasn't really been studied a lot. It's kind of an up-and-coming thing. So if we have the money, we'll get the nutritional analysis done on it. But other than that, I haven't really seen it for consumption. But everywhere I go, all the scientific research says that, yeah, it could probably be consumed because all the other animals eat it, and it seems to be fine. So if anyone wants to be guinea pig, let me know. But the trick is for eating these floating pond plants, duckweed, I'll talk about that because it's known consumption for humans, is it you want to make sure it's grown in an environment that is free from any pollution, like chemicals or heavy metals and that kind of stuff, because it sucks that out of the system and it actually would concentrate into the plant. Which is great if you're trying to clean up an environmental waste place. You can throw these floating pond plants in, it'll suck mercury or, you know, the bad stuff out, fertilizer runoff from farms for bioremediation. Actually, azolla, there's a theory out here, it's kind of wild, but there's a theory that azolla stopped the greenhouse effect 50 million years ago when we had dinosaurs. It populated up in Antarctica, had a big azolla bloom, it dropped the temperature of the earth, and so there's people up there in the oil industry looking for this azolla because it's oil now. So know, it's pretty crazy stuff. For us, we want to contain duckweed and azolla. So I have my 12 original tips, which you guys can find online, for growing duckweed and azolla. And I'll use them interchangeably because they're the same. So this is what I came up with, guys. Duckweed prefers slow-moving water. So you won't find it in any rivers. You will find it in nature, in ponds, lakes, maybe some slow-moving rivers. And speaking of finding it in nature, we found duckweed in Haiti.
And they float.
Yeah, you remember you just... Sorry, you just get your stupid loon.
And it reproduces very quickly as well.
Just in a pond. It's crazy. Duckweed naturally happens in most of North America. The azolla we have comes from the Carolinas, so it happens in the East Coast. So it's not like we're introducing native plants. People consider them noxious because they grow so fast. But you need basically still water. You know, we have an IBC tote here at Still. We have this aquarium here at Still. And grow it in several places. Like the slides I showed you, you want to grow it in several different places. Now, if you go home with a cup of duckweed a day, I'd split it up in four, personally. Because you might fail in one spot, and if that's your mother batch, you know, don't put all your eggs in one basket. And you'll find that the duckweed or azolla will grow a little different in this spot than this spot. Like the duckweed will actually look bigger and be a little different color green than this stuff over here. It's kind of neat. Because it grows asexually. So let's say the small duckweed grows best over here. It's going to reproduce and overtake the big duckweed. That's why. So don't grow duckweed in the same place that you're raising fish. Okay? I get a lot of people, Dennis, I got your duckweed in the mail. I put it in my tank and it's gone. Yeah, because the fish love it. So what we have over here is a little setup. This is called an aquatic plant basket. I'll hold it up for you guys. Called an aquatic plant basket. And this one happens to fit perfectly on a 10-gallon fish tank here. Absolutely perfect. So what we have here is a little grow setup here, a light. We have our duckweed in the top of the basket so the fish can't get it. It still has all the nutrients. It has a little bubble stone down here to grow. Feed the fish. Just go like this one. Feeding the fish. It's pretty neat. Now the neat thing is, if you're growing fish normally in a tank, you can overfeed your fish and it'll kill them that day. You know, because fish food you buy at the store, guys, it turns to poison in about an hour or so. Like if you, that's why they say only feed your fish as much flakes as they can eat in 5 minutes, 2 minutes. Yeah. Because if not, it's going to turn to bad stuff. So this, I can leave this duckweed in here forever. And it's just going to sit there and purify the water. So it's really great stuff. But you need something like this if you're going to grow it with your fish. Surface area. Duckweed and azolla need a lot of surface area. So if you're trying to grow a lot and you want to do it big, you'll need something with a lot of surface area, like one of these IBC chalk tops or a humongous kiddie pool. In the back, I have what we call the bunk beds, and they're almost 4x8, raised 4x8 plywood with raised 2x6s, and there's three levels, so that's a lot of square footage in a small footprint, and that's our commercial production. It's lined with pond liner, and the water at the bottom, it drains. But as much surface area as you can. You don't need a whole lot of depth of water. This is actually twice as much as you need as far as depth. So I say 6 inches is good. 3 inches is a little too low, because what happens when you grow duckweed, duckweed is real simple. It's a real simple plant. A lot more simple than azolla. But duckweed is basically just two or three leaves, but they don't have any veins in them at all, and it's just a simple root. So eventually it splits, and sometimes the roots might fall off. And then if you're going for, you know, a year or so, those roots will build up and it becomes like silt. So you need to be a little taller than that to get away from that, because that can get acidic. So. So 6 inches is great, guys. That's what you want. Bless you. Duckweed grows faster in warm weather. Okay. Now, we have a problem in wintertime growing duckweed. I mean, it barely exists. It barely happens. So we have to, you know, kind of keep it as warm as possible, grow it indoors just fine. So then we switch to Azolla in the off season, and it grows great, and we've been so happy. So Azolla in colder weather does better than duckweed in the warmer weather. And the neat thing about these plants, guys, is you can use them interchangeably for the same purposes. Whether or not you're growing Azolla and duckweed for chicken, or for cattle, for pigs, for ducks, for tilapia fish, or for human consumption, they're basically about the same. I consider them complementary.
Can they grow in the same pond?
Yeah, they can. But eventually, one will overtake the other one. That's what I've noticed.
Well, will they flip-flop on the seasons?
Yeah, sure. And as long as it doesn't starve out the other one. But usually it doesn't. Usually, if it's a brighter, sunnier, warmer place, the duckweed usually takes over. And you might see a few flecks of the Azolla still hanging in there. And in wintertime, those flecks will take over. So it wouldn't be a problem at all. If you keep it indoors, you guys are fine because the water temperature is probably about 70 degrees or so. And you can grow with one of these LED lights. Now this is just one you can find it at the hardware stores. But it's the blue color. You see how these lights up here are more yellowish and this is more blue. This will stimulate springtime. It'll tell the plant, grow, grow, grow. It's time to grow. And I have it concentrated on one area here. Just for what we need to grow. So this could be a really great production. So if I turn this on, this is a light meter. And it tells me I have like 26,000 lux, which is bright enough to grow tomatoes. Because we have one light bulb that's about a 60-70 watt equivalent spotlight concentrated into a 1 foot area. So more than enough light to grow a lot. You can also grow in something like these 10-20 trays. Here, show you guys. These are the tick-tock trays. A lot of people who start seeds might be familiar with these. These ones are actually triple trays. Awesome. Okay, so you don't have to throw them away after a couple of seeds. It's really great. And then you can put a long bubble stone like we have in here. Mm-hmm. And for one of these, I would recommend T5 fluorescent, 2-footer. It's like perfect. And you want to hold it close. So I'll turn this on to show you. It's a high output. They're really bright. They're the most energy efficient fluorescents for growing. So, like that would be perfect. And you just want to put a bubble stone in here. But you could have a bookshelf with lots of those going on. It'd be great. If you don't add the oxygen, the bubble stone, if you don't add the bubble stone, eventually the plants will suffocate and they'll just die. So. Speaking of dying, you know your duckweed's dying when it slowly turns from a dark green to a yellowish green to a yellow and then to a white. And the Azolla seems to just shrivel up, turn a little whitish, and disappear. So they both eventually turn white, and that's when you know something's wrong. So if you immediately notice the good green color changing, then that's when you want to act. You might want to split it up and put it in a couple different places before you lose your mother supply. But a great place to keep a mother supply. Another idea would be to get a bucket. You don't need a 5 gallon. You can get a 2.5 gallon. Get one of these plant lights, a CFL. Put a bubble stone in there, a little aquarium bubble stone. And you'll grow a good supply of duckweed. And you'll grow a lot. But if you're growing outside, let's see here. Oh. Don't forget the nutrients. You can't just put water in your bucket and expect to grow. If you have a fish tank, you can clean your fish tank with one of those gravel suckers. You know, it gets all the brown water. Put it in your bucket. That'd be great, or your 10-20 trays. Or, if you want something, a quick fix, we have this compost tea. It's made by Botanicare. It basically has earthworms, castings. Some seabird and kelp, I believe. It's really good stuff. You can use this as a straight hydroponic solution to grow full cycle too. It's really good stuff.
How about your chicken poop?
Chicken poop would be good as well. You just want to dry it out first before you try that. Chicken poop would be excellent for azolla because azolla does really great with a lot of phosphates, excuse me, or phosphorus, excuse me. And it's one of the things, you need nutrients in the water and it needs more nutrients. However, azolla needs less nutrients than duckweed because it takes the nitrogen out of the air, which is good.
Yes. Mm-hmm. With a compost tea, would you have to change the water out every once in a while?
Yeah, you would. With a little bucket set up like this, probably every 3 weeks or so, you can tell by the color of your duckweed and how it's going.
But you're changing a little bit of the water or the whole thing?
Dump it out and water your plants.
Okay.
And your plants will grow great. But you want to get your nutrients. Because even though it might have a lot of nutrients still in the water, some of the trace nutrients
are
might be gone.
Yeah.
So it'll eventually nutrition starve itself. It needs everything it gets. That's the downside with hydroponics. That's truly hydroponic growing right there. I'm sticking with two varieties here of duckweed. One variety of duckweed and one variety of azolla because we've grown different stuff and this is what grows the best. So I could show you all these different varieties of duckweed. There's giant duckweed, red duckweed, all different types of azolla too, bigger azollas. But this seems to grow really great and they're about the same size, so I think it's the best stuff to grow. Let's see. You reach a point when the duckweed gets so thick, right now in here it's maybe a quarter inch thick. Half inch to three quarter inch is about as thick as it gets before the sunlight won't penetrate and the duckweed won't grow underneath there anymore. So half inch to three quarter inch is about as thick as it gets. So if you ever reach that point, take half of it out and grow it somewhere else because you've plateaued. You know, you don't need to, you can take that out and start somewhere else. Or call me and I'll take some more. let's see. Well, there's very little farming involved. Now, like I said, they've been trying this in developing countries, and I've shipped hundreds of quarter cups of duckweed all across every state in America, and I get feedback about how people do, and I can usually troubleshoot what they did wrong. If you get it in the mail, don't put it out in the blazing sun if you're in Vegas or Phoenix for that matter. Just like any other plant, you have to adjust it to strong light. Okay. It's really easy to grow indoors. That's a good thing. And I think it's dummy proof. But there is one predator that can grow in the same environment as azolla and duckweed. Algae. And really, that's the only maintenance involved in growing duckweed is you really have to rake it until it gets real thick. And once it gets real thick, you don't have to worry about it. But let's see if I can find anything. Ah, look at that. See, it shouldn't be stringing like that, right? So what I do is I just shake the clumps under the water, and once the duckweed falls out, we want that duckweed. So you can go down to the pet stores and buy algae in a bag. It's a nutritional treat for your fish. So it's the same stuff we're growing here. Any other questions? Gotta be some questions, guys.
Okay, the protein. So you just grab a clump out of that and throw it in your drink in the morning?
If you're growing it real clean in a bucket
right.
with hydro solution, organic hydro solution, just rinse it out and you're good to go. If you're growing it in dirtier conditions like an aquarium or pond or a garden pool,
right.
you're going to want to clean it off with food grade hydrogen peroxide.
Okay.
And the oxygen will kill anything that's happening there. And visually check for any snails or anything like that that might be there.
Okay.
Other than that, it's a lot of protein, more protein than soy. Really, really good stuff.
Amazing.
And the neat thing is it's really digestible for your body because there's no fibers. Like, you know, that's the stuff that our body can't digest. So it's really good stuff. There's been talk about using this as biofuel because it has high starch content. You know, it's really cool stuff. I think it's future right here. We're looking at something futuristic. But it's been around for us in our, you know, for thousands of years for people. But we've helped universities grow duckweed. And it's kind of funny. You can tell they're science people. So they'll take all their duckweed and they'll throw it and give it all this stuff and they'll immediately kill it. Like, no, you know, if you're growing something and you want to keep it around, you want to have a mother batch. And then if you want to experiment with that, you can. You know, let your mother batch grow and you can have more experiment duckweed. So, yes?
How much growth area do you need per fish to sustain them?
Well, if you have a big pond like I have about 50 square feet for growing that. Now, a 10-gallon fish tank, you could have 1 square foot, and that's more than enough. This will feed the fish in here, and then probably maybe 2 more other fish tanks. So, maybe a quarter of your surface area of your pond. I think that's a good, a quarter to a fifth, something like that. So, you can get creative. You know, you could have a little pump that pumps up to this tray and grow duckweed here and empties into your aquarium. You just want a lot of surface area. That's why I find bookshelves great, because you can get a lot of surface area in a small footprint, or, you know, bunk beds like we have outside. Because that's the only thing you need surface area. So you can't grow vertical. Yes?
Like in a pond, like behind you,
yeah.
What's the weight production that you get on average? Like,
Pretty good. The reason why I like doing these IBC chop things is because I think the water gets a little warmer outside during the summer. He has put bubble stones in there. And you want the water level to be constant. You don't want something ebb and flow happening. Because what happens is the azolla sticks to the side or the duckweed sticks to the side and it dies before the water comes back up. I see it a lot. So constant water, ability to get warm. I throw maybe 4 or 5 bubble stones in there and you have a floating pond plant machine.
If you harvested that whole thing, do you know how much it would weigh?
Maybe about 5 pounds or so. I don't do a whole lot of weight
and
that stuff. My thing I need to get better at. So. Yes?
Can you feed duckweed with fish emulsion?
I don't like to, personally. You're better off with a compost tea. You're better off with urea, honestly, urine, than fish emulsion. So if you're going to do something like urea, I would do it like 1 to 20, really, really weak. But it has stuff in there. Phosphorus, nitrogen, that kind of stuff, that's good for it. But personally, I advise everybody to use compost tea or fish, you know, fish waste.
Yes. How often do you have to replenish the solution with fish waste to keep it
I guess going? About every 3 weeks or so.
3 weeks, okay.
Depending on how fast it's growing. But you can tell, I can tell by walking in and just looking at the color, whether or not it has what it needs.
And you said that the duckweed absorbs toxins and pollution.
It does.
How do you know that it has so that you don't eat it? I mean, you can't eat it, right?
Well, you would know because if your water is polluted or not. You can get tests done through the county with, like, analysis of your water. They do it for people with wells all the time. There's even test kits you can order online. So if you're concerned about a pond that's maybe questionable, I would do that definitely. If you think you have mercury in your pond, test it, because it'll be concentrated in your plants. But test the water a year later, we keep adding the plants, and maybe the mercury levels have been dropped 95%. And at that point, you can harvest, you know, the plants, get rid of them, put some new plants in there, and you're good to go. So, great question.
If you grew in a kiddie pool, would you have to change out the water, like with a little bucket?
You wouldn't have to change out the water unless you're growing, well, if you're growing a compost tea, you would have to. So you might want to scoop the duckweed out or whatever and put it in a bucket. Just, you can step on kiddie pools, they'll fall over or try to lift them up. And then add your water and then put the duckweed back in. So if you're going to be a duckweed farmer, you know, you're really going to want something like this. So, nice big wide mouth one.
But wouldn't it balance itself out somewhat with evaporation and just putting in some fresh water and old water evaporating?
It does. For smaller areas, because we're talking about a shallow thing with a lot of surface area.
Mm-hmm.
So I know a fish tank will lose at least 3 weeks, that's a good part of the tank there.
Yeah.
So you probably just add more water. But eventually stuff like calcium might build up, so
yeah,
you're going to have to dump it. That's why I like growing it in ponds and that kind of stuff, or even a fish tank setup. Now, if you're growing it with a fish tank, you'll have to change your water less.
Yes.
Than not using duckweed, which is really nice because it absorbs your waste.
So what are some of your rotation cycles? I mean, are you doing mostly 3 weeks to keep it simple and you start kind of a new batch?
Yeah,
or
3 weeks is what I say.
Okay.
And for optimal production,
yes,
you're going to want to make sure you harvest too.
Yes.
Because like I said, you'll reach a plateau where your duckweed finally gets thick, that it's going to drown out all the algae, but then it kind of stops growing.
Yeah.
So at least take half of it out a week. If it's, you have a full-on thing going, take half of it out a week, let it get down to where you want it to at least always cover the surface area. That way algae never grows. And I like buckets and trays because light can't come in sideways. If you have an aquarium outside, you're probably still going to grow algae in here because light's going to hit it, and that'll compete for the nutrients too fast.
Do you use any of those warming pads, you know what I'm talking about, like that little tray you have there, would that help in the winter?
You could in the wintertime. That would probably be a good idea. We don't personally, but that's a good idea. They have warming pads that are perfect size for those kind of trays there.
With this working like a fountain?
Yeah.
Would that provide enough air, or do I still have to figure out how to get it?
That's probably enough air if you have it going regularly. You're probably going to want to grow Azolla, because Azolla, you'll need less nutrients. Like I said, smaller things, you want to stick with Azolla. And if it's not as sunny...
What's about the size of that, the bottom of it, the pool part?
Oh, okay. Yeah, that'd be great. Do you have fish in it?
No, I wanted to get mosquito fish.
Okay, yeah. Mosquito fish are great. Thank you for reminding me. So anywhere you have growing duckweed outside, little bodies of water that are still are great for mosquitoes. And until you get a lot of duckweed that's too thick for the mosquitoes or Azolla to get in and out, once it gets thick, it's a barrier, and it's actually preventative measure for mosquitoes. But until it reaches that point, you can grow mosquitoes in there. So we tell people to grow gambusia, which are these little fish right here. And they're mosquito fish. They go around and eat mosquitoes. And you can pick them up for free. Vector Control has them. Vector Control. They're downtown. It's one of the county programs. They use it for people with empty pools. You throw those puppies in there, you don't have to worry about West Nile mosquitoes happening.
And what was the name of that fish again? Gambusia?
Gambusia, or mosquito fish. You can just look at mosquito fish. Some call them gambusia. But, Azolla, see the duckweed grows the best at this place here. Look how sunny and bright it is. And they have a lot of fish there. And we get most of our Azolla from the Fantasy Farm. This place, which gets more shade. So if duckweed's not growing real good here, I'll take it out. Why waste my time and throw in some Azolla and give it a shot? And it will probably grow better than the duckweed would, and vice versa. So I consider them complementary. Just like we use water hyacinth and water lettuce, these are two more complementary plants that serve very similar purposes. But I want everybody to learn how to grow it, and then it'll spread like duckweed.
Are there food recipes you want to prepare duckweed?
We'll put some online, what we have, with the same post. We already have a page on how to grow duckweed. But as we come up with more stuff, we'll add more stuff. The smoothie that we've done, some people have seen us do the smoothie. Danielle, do you remember how to make that smoothie? Yogurt?
I think we did like apple juice and yogurt, duckweed. It was really simple.
It tastes like lettuce. It doesn't have a strong taste at all. And it's just like
if you do like a morning drink.
I haven't tasted as well like that, though.
You said that I might have missed it, but you said that you could reintroduce the chicken waste into there, mm-hmm. the chicken food. Would you have to supplement it then at some point, because you're obviously taking meat out, and then would there be a loss there at some point? Would you have to supplement some of the
nutrients? Yeah, you would have to have some sort of outside inputs coming in.
Yeah.
Like, we let our chickens run around in the yard, and they eat grass too, okay. And bugs and snails and all that kind of stuff.
So you're taking it from the yard?
Yeah.
Does it grow, the plant, I don't remember the name of it, that you have out in the ponds, the big one with the crunchy stuff in it?
Uh-huh.
I can't remember the name
hyacinth, water hyacinth.
Okay. Does it grow okay with that?
Yeah. There, and that's another edible plant for humans.
You said it tastes like air?
Yeah, it kind of just tastes like air. Really weird. It's like styrofoam on the inside. You break over one of those bulbs.
The blackbird's found it in the air.
Oh, no. You can have some more to help yourself. We do have starter kits available for duckweed and azolla. We also have the pond baskets, if anyone's interested in the super thick 1020 trays, botanic care supplies. I didn't mention lights. If you're growing in an aquarium, turn your light off for your fish, because your fish will go nuts and get real aggressive. So you want to have at least 8 hours of rest for your fish, sake. And your plants really don't need much more light than that anyway. You reach a point where you're just wasting electricity. Adam.
Sorry, Adam. That's the silliest duckweed question that we've ever been asked.
A guy wanted his money back because it didn't grow as fast as it said in the video. It's like, Dennis, it's been 4 days and it hasn't doubled. Well, I'm sorry, I can't guarantee a green thumb. But, it's a cat.
What did you say you put on the bottom? Some sort of stone?
A bubble stone, an air stone.
Where is that?
You can see one here in our aquarium. You get them any pet store. It's a little air pump, the tubing, and it diffuses the air, and it just bubbles.
So it's plugged in.
Right, it is plugged in.
Okay.
Yeah, it's right around the corner.
That was some magic stone. I was pretty excited about that. I need one of those.
Cool. we read everywhere that duckweed needs still water. And then what we noticed in the garden pool is where our inlets would kick on, where the water would spray, that's where it really grew thick. And I thought, okay, it grows by splitting, so that must help it split. So then we started putting bubble stones in, and now Erin has bubble stones in her setup, and it's, you know, she can get 8 cups in 4 days, which is a lot of biomass, so it just really helps it.
So it doesn't do well with running water, but it does.
Running water, not so much. If it's slow running water, it would be okay. But really, the still water, the better, the slight agitation.
Fountain would be
perfect. Okay. Really great. You'll notice thick clumps probably where the water sprays and creates that little pulse. Yes?
Until I get fish, like, to grow the duckweed, should I, like, to replace the water, should I let the water, like, city water sit and let the chlorine evaporate? Or?
I really haven't had any problems. Duckweed's pretty hardy stuff. I haven't had any problems with that at all. You know, fish I'm more cautious of, but duckweed's pretty interesting.
The chlorine hurts the fish gills, but it doesn't do anything to plants.
Yeah, if anything, it'll kill any microorganisms that's on the plant or something like that. So. Yes?
Now, for your chicken and fish, is their diet primarily the duckweed, or what is the...
For fish, a majority of it is algae. It grows really, really fast. I think of duckweed as dessert.
Okay.
You know, it has good stuff for them, but they would just eat as much as I could ever grow. They would gorge themselves. They would never stop eating it. Algae just grows like crazy. And then, you know, snails and all that kind of stuff go for the fish. Now, for the chickens, they eat the bigger floating pond plants. They love water hyacinth. So that's a bulk of their diet. And then they also eat black silverfly larvae, duckweed as well. But those are more supplements to the nutrition. When you're feeding animals, you want to have a wide variety of what you feed them. Mm-hmm. We have their bulk of their fodder, which is algae and hyacinth. That stuff grows like crazy. I don't know how many pounds of water hyacinth I grow, because we can pull out a big, big, big area every week. You know, that stuff. Pull nets and nets and nets of that stuff. So we have one garden. eats that like crazy because it's never any food for them. It's really great. Any other questions? All right, guys. Thank you for coming to the class.